Welcome back to History Class with Dr. W and our continuing study of Vietnam. In our last set of lectures, we explored the early history of Vietnam, which might be characterized by two prominent themes: the political, economic, social, and cultural influence of China, and efforts by the Vietnamese to assert their independence. At the end of those lectures, we introduced another factor into this dynamic: the arrival of French Catholic missionaries in the 16th and 17th century. In the next several lectures, we'll be discussing the period of French involvement in Vietnam and the surrounding region known at that time as Indochina. For the first few lectures, this meant a period of French influence and the growing importance of Catholic missionaries. Later, though, we will see the French involvement evolve into full-blown conquest and imperial domination, a period that lasts deep into the 20th century. The conclusion of that period will bring us to the doorstep of American entanglement in Vietnam. French missionaries and Catholicism began making inroads in Vietnam at just a time in its history when Vietnam was especially vulnerable to outside influence. Vietnam had undergone a period of colonial expansion. Remember, in an earlier lecture, we talked about the defeat and conquest of the Cham. During this period, Viet rulers encountered some of the same challenges their own colonizers had experienced in previous centuries: civil wars, the expense of military conquest and control, the influence of local elites and strongmen. All meant that Viet leadership had many distractions. The nation was stretched thin and vulnerable. In the 1500s, Vietnamese leadership fell prey to civil war. Ultimately, by the mid-1500s, three military houses ruled a divided Vietnam: one region in the far north near the Chinese border, another around Hanoi and the Red River Delta, and a third in the southern borderlands. In very general terms, the northern regions tended to be ruled in more strict fashion, by leaders who presided over elaborate military and religious rituals, banners and symbols, and loyalty oaths. The southern regions continued to enjoy a greater sense of diversity and international influence, especially from overseas and India. Bustling port cities featured an array of languages, customs, and foods, and no one ethnic group held a strong majority. Thus, these areas tended to be more tolerant and relaxed in their policies. As one scholar has put it, talent and ability began to count for more than birth and position. For those who may be more familiar with American history, I would make a rough comparison here with the North American colonies of New England and the Middle Colonies. New England was governed by strict Puritan measures. The middle colonies, like New York, featured much more diversity and tolerance. It is in the southern regions that Nguyen Hoang built a new imperial state beginning in the late 16th century and continuing through the 17th century. This dynasty, the Nguyen Dynasty, oversaw a richly diverse region. Its founder, Nguyen Hoang, was attracted by the beauty and exoticism of the southern lands, the beautiful scenery, and the riches the land promised. Gradually, the region came to be influenced not only by traders from India, but also from China, Europe, and elsewhere. Nguyen's control in the south moved gradually, rather than in one swift conquest. It is a military movement, make no mistake, and military conquest was one factor driving further southern settlement. But over long periods of time, many decades, Nguyen soldiers, farmers, and settlers inched further down the coast, ultimately approaching the Mekong Delta in the far south. Intermarriage, collaboration, and borrowing from local customs were common. While the Vietnamese carried their own culture south with them, they also adopted many ways of the indigenous people, especially the Cham, who had dominated that region previously. Because they didn't have the military might to exert full control, The Nguyen were forced to compromise and accept some level of local rule. Their rule typically was indirect. Local military and provincial officials held sway as power moved away from the center and capital in Hue, which is far from the Mekong Delta and other areas that were being settled. Vietnamese came to refer to this new southern province as Dong Trong, meaning inner region, the outer region in this comparison, contrast to another state in the far north. Eventually, the northern leaders in Hanoi, known as the Trinh after their founder Trinh Kiem, grew tired of the independence and success of the Nguyen and began launching attacks against them. Seven different times in the 17th century, from 1620 to 1672, the Trinh invaded the south. All seven times, they were repulsed by the Nguyen. For all intents and purposes, during this period, there were two distinct and independent Vietnams. In our next lecture, we'll discuss a group of three brothers who rode to power in the midst of this chaos in an episode known as the Tay Son Revolt.